everybody. Welcome to the Audit and Governance Committee. It's our inaugural meeting. And we now move to appoint the Deputy Chair. So can I have a nomination, please, for the Deputy Chair?
Can I move Councillor Carr?
Are we a seconder? Agreed. Thank you. Welcome, Mr. Carr, Councillor Carr. Have we got the apologies for absence, please?
Apologies for Councillor Grunwald and Councillor Hurley.
Thank you. Have we got the declarations of interest? No? Right, can we move on to the main part of the agenda, which is the presentations, external audit arrangements from Tim Cutter from KPMG. So if you could step forward and entertain us.
Today's presentation is really to give you an introduction to the approach we will be taking as your appointed auditors, and thereby giving you an idea of the assurances that you can take from our work. I've set out there the kind of areas we're going to cover. I am more than happy to take questions during the presentation, or alternatively wait till the end, however you would prefer. But really, those items there give you an idea of how external audit is done within the combined authority, the outputs that you will see, thereby giving you assurance on the work that we've done, and also talking a little bit about how you as committee can respond to that work. I'll also introduce the team right at the end. So, background to this, again, some of you may be familiar with this if you've attended audit committees in your constituent authorities, but we are appointed by the Audit Commission, not by the authority itself. We are restricted by a code of audit practice, which sets out very clearly the work that we do. And in conjunction with that independent appointment, fees are also set independently. I'll come on to talk a little bit about what that covers within the code of audit practice and what the fees cover very shortly. So, the code of audit practice requires us to carry out work in two distinct areas. The first of which, no doubt, you'll be familiar with the idea of audit elsewhere, in that we carry out an audit of the financial statements. So in so doing, we are going to become satisfied that the accounts comply with statutory requirements. We need to be satisfied that proper practices have been observed in compiling the accounts, and we'll work with John and his team to observe and to comment on that practice. And we'll, at the end of the year, provide an opinion on the accounts and how that will look in that we'll give a true and fair opinion, that the items reported in the financial statements give a fair reflection of the authority's activities for the year. The second aspect of our work under the code of practice is around the use of resources, more commonly known as value for money work. And in so doing, and through the work that we do, and by exception it's important to add, this isn't a substantive look throughout all activities of the authority, through the work that we do, if anything comes to our attention that suggests resources aren't used in an economic, efficient and effective way, we would bring those to the attention of the Audit Committee and subsequently the Audit Commission. But again, necessarily expect that to be the case. Very briefly, looking across the local government sector, again, the approach that we take will differ slightly to what you may see in your constituent local authorities, predominantly around the work on use of resources. For example, within a local authority, the work on use of resources tends to be more substantive and detailed in nature. With the combined authorities, more of a light touch approach, and again, it's more by exception on through the work that we do, should anything to our attention, we will report it to this audit committee. And again, that's a similar approach that we've taken in previous years with the PTE and previously the ITA. Worth noting, and again, this has been well publicised, from 31st of March, the Audit Commission will cease to exist. Therefore, our contract and our appointment to you will be transferred to what is becoming known as Public Sector Audit Appointments Limited, which is being hosted by the LGA. They will manage our contract and our appointment to you to either 2017 or 2020, depending on how those contracts will be extended. There's a decision point in the summer as to how long we will be appointed to you. And again, the PSAA, as it's known, will carry on the responsibilities of the Audit Commission in setting our fees, making our appointments, and assuring the quality of the work we do with you, and I'll come on to refer to that shortly. So, what does quality assurance look like? Well, clearly we are all trained and qualified auditors with experience in local governments and the wider public sector, and that's your assurance around how we recruit and retain highly skilled staff. We have an established audit methodology that we use in local government, which will be applicable to combined authorities, given the nature of the accounting and similar practices. Both I and the manager on the audit will review all of the work we do, and we are experienced in looking across different authorities and see what best practice looks like. We then have different tiers of review within the firm, through other partners reviewing our work. Then ultimately, the PSAA will pick a sample of KPMG audits each year to assure that our methodology and the approaches that individuals are taking meets the required standards. And again, we will report to you that that is the case, or indeed if that is not the case. Okay, so what will you expect to see from us during the year? Well, in subsequent meetings, we will issue an audit fee letter, which confirms the level of the fee that we will charge for the current year. Initially, as it's said there, this has been set at just over 47,000, which essentially reflects the fee that was set for the ITA in previous years. And again, what the Audit Commission and subsequently the new body will do is review the level of operations that are occurring through the combined authority and keep that under review. Following that, we will produce a detailed audit plan which sets out the risks, and again, I'll come on to what our initial view is on those. And within the audit plan, we will say how we will approach our work and the kind of areas we will look at and identify as risks. Following the production of the financial statements, we will then produce our opinions on both financial statements and use resources, and we will bring to you a report known as the ISA 260 report, which will present all of our findings and conclusions in relation to both aspects of our work. Following that, you can then adopt the approved accounts. And then finally, and this is an Audit Commission requirement, we will produce an annual audit letter, which is a higher level summary of those findings, which is then posted on the authority's website and into the public domain. And again, the planned date for the end of our work for this audit year will be in October with the production of the annual audit letter. Okay, I mean, it may be helpful just to give you an idea of the timings of those various reports and milestones. So again, we're suggesting that what we've already communicated the fee, obviously, as part of this presentation, subsequent progress reports to other audit committees, with the ISA 260 to the September committee, and the annual audit letter to an October deadline. And again, the various aspects of work that we carry out during the year are listed there. We would expect to do much of the planning and systems work through February and March, with the final accounts work happening in July and August, with firm dates to be confirmed with John and his team. So, what is our role to you at this committee? We're here to present those reports, completed and agreed with management. We're here to explain the findings and the work we've done to reach those conclusions. But equally, we're here to provide independent assurance to you. So it could be within those reports there's nothing that you either weren't expecting or nothing that you haven't heard before, but it should be of comfort for you to know that somebody independent has come in, reviewed the activities of the authority, and confirmed what management are telling you. But again, we're here to answer your questions, should you have any, or receive feedback or give you clarification on some of the detail within the report. So again, the opportunity to question us after we've presented those reports will be there. So in return, how perhaps should you receive our reports? Well, you can discuss them, the plans of the reports, either before or during the meetings. You can consider the impact of the findings and the messages we're telling you on the business of the audit committee. You can challenge the assumptions, assessments made either by us in reaching our conclusions, or indeed by management in reaching the assumptions in the financial statements. You may decide that further work is necessary to mitigate a risk that you perceive in the approach. And also, we would recommend meeting with us once a year in private to have any discussion that you wish to have without management listening. That's not a particular requirement for this authority, but it seems to be best practice across the sector. So, we've highlighted there, and appreciate that, so that's difficult to read on the screen, but hopefully you can see it better in your packs, just an initial cut of what we see financial statement opinion risks being. It should be comforting to know at this point there are no reds on that screen, which are what we would deem to be significant risks to the audit opinion. But we have highlighted a few amber areas, and really these are areas that we'll be looking to explore through conversations with management as we move through the audit period. So for example, how will the reporting with the group be disclosed, you know, with the PTE and other bodies, constituent authorities within the group? How will growth fund monies be accounted for within the combined authority? What are the interrelationships with other bodies, related parties, as they're known in the financial statements? And again, we're not suggesting they are risks at this point, but they're areas that we would want to discuss with management and gain comfort over. And equally, what are the issues around value for money? And again, at this point, we don't know the answers to these. These are just developed from our experience of working with other combined authorities and understanding the policy agenda, and we've put a few of those ideas up there. So, for example, how will the peer review be followed up? How is the interaction with the PTE or the committee managed? And other relationships, for example, with the lab. And finally, just to introduce the team, as I've said, I'm the partner. I'll be responsible for signing the audit opinion and overseeing the policy of the work we do and the relationship with you. Ian Warwick is the manager, who will manage very much the relationship with management and the work we do, coordinating on the ground. And Richard Tyler is our assistant manager, who will lead all the field work with the authority. You would expect to see either Ian or myself at all of the audit committee meetings presenting to you. That's all I was planning on saying. More than happy to take any questions.
Do we have any questions? All right, Councillor Carr, then Councillor Robinson.
Auditor for what was previously an integrated transport authority, obviously now the combined authority. Whilst I'm very pleased to see that the fee has not increased, that's very encouraging. How has the scope of work changed at all with the transition from being purely an integrated transport authority now to being a combined authority?
I mean, the full answer to that needs to be developed over the next few weeks and months once we get our heads around how financial reporting will work. And importantly, meetings like today, what the governance structures of the combined authority that we need to observe and pass comments on. I mean, we're also aware from the constitution of the combined authority that there's a potential for other decisions to be made, not purely around transport, but around other areas in line with the constitution. So it's really our role to keep a watching brief around all of those and make sure that whenever decisions are being made, that robust governance arrangements are being put in place around.
Okay, so anybody, any more questions? No? Can we move on then to item 6, please? Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Internal Audit Overview. To you, Mr. Poppington.
Good morning. I think everybody should know who I am, but just in case, my name is John Poppington. I act as the treasurer for the Combined Authority, most of the direction resources at Merseytravel. Merseytravel are the accountable body for the combined authority. Equally, my counterpart at Holton provides in section 151 responsibility in respect of policy and policies, transport expenditure. Just very briefly, by way of introduction to this, this is about the internal audit arrangements, which clearly are very significant part of that overall governance framework. This is the first year of the CA, clearly, and these revised governance arrangements and income and expenditure, as has previously been mentioned, are pretty much exclusively transport related. So as such, we determined in this year that the internal audit arrangements at Merseytravel and at Halton will continue to provide assurance to the combined authority around that income and expenditure. We've not changed anything in particular around the internal audit for this year, clearly, and that would include also the audit and governance committees at Halton and at Merseytravel too, being part of that assurance framework. Obviously, as the CA evolves into other areas within its remit, and in particular from next year when it starts to receive other funding streams around growth fund, around potentially skills capital, rural leader money, other funding streams get routed through the CA, possibly will need to review those audit arrangements to make sure they continue to be effective, and this committee will be instrumental in conducting that review. But for this year anyway, as stated, we will be retaining the existing audit arrangements at Halton and at Merseytravel, and you as a committee need to be assured that they are appropriate and effective. So that said, what I've asked the Chief Internal Auditor of Merseytravel in particular here to present is Merseytravel's audit plan, and also with reference to Halton's as well, for this year, because although they've not changed, the amount of money that have been routed through the CA are very, very significant in terms of total tolls and levies, fares, and you know the risks are still there. So if I could just hand over to Stephanie Donaldson, the Chief Internal Auditor of Merseytravel.
Thanks, John. I'll just take the opportunity to introduce Andrew Delacroix from Halton. We've produced this report jointly, myself and the Divisional Manager of Audit and Operational Finance at Halton. We produced this together. As John's already said, then this report takes into consideration both Merseytravel and Halton's audit activity, which together currently provide assurance to the Liverpool City region. The report covers the internal audit arrangements, the risk management arrangements, general governance considerations, and also the respective compliance of both Halton and Merseytravel with the mandatory public sector internal audit standards. The 2014-15 Merseytravel internal audit plans attached at Appendix A. That plan contains all the necessary work to provide the appropriate levels of assurance on the overall systems of internal control necessary for the production of Merseytravel's annual governance statement. Delivery of the plan is obviously still ongoing. We've just commenced quarter four, and the plan itself was approved by the Merseytravel Audit and Governance Subcommittee in July 2014. There's been no significant findings thus far in relation to combined authority assets or financial management during the audit reviews that have been completed so far. Core financial fundamental system work has yet to commence. That will be undertaken during this quarter. Members will note at paragraph 2.13 that Merseytravel did commission additional specialist IT audit provision in year to undertake IT and information governance work. You'll see Appendix B that there's a breakdown of the work that's been undertaken and is ongoing from that provider through our software internal audit services. In terms of Halton Borough Council also produced an internal audit plan, and that plan was approved by their Business Efficiency Board. That board fulfills the role of the audit committee at Halton. In accordance with the transitional arrangements of the combined authority, the integrated transport block and the highways maintenance funding was paid directly to Halton from the DFT, and at a confirmation from the Divisional Manager of Audit and Operational Finance at Halton that both these grants have been subject to the relevant levels of grant assurance, and there's no significant findings to report. Whilst no additional internal audit work at Halton is being undertaken in the year that directly relates to the combined authority, provision is being made in the 2015-16 plan to enable specific insurance work around combined authority funding streams to be carried out. In respect to the public sector internal audit standards, as an entity in its own right, the combined authority is required to ensure that the internal audit function is compliant, and the public sector internal audit standards came into effect in April 2013. The principles of the standards are based on and replace the previous CIPFA code of practice for internal audit in local government. Both Merseytravel and Halton have undertaken, you'll see, their self-assessments against the standards. Both have produced action plans for areas that require addressing. However, none of these areas are considered significant and all are on target to be completed by March 2015. For information, any significant non-compliance with the standards does have to be reported in the government scheme. At the present, there's no reason to believe that would be necessary from either ourselves or from Halton. In terms of the section 4, the board, the standards themselves require that an organisation must define who its board are in terms of the standards itself. From Merseytravel's perspective, that role is fulfilled currently by the Audit and Governance Subcommittee. From Halton's perspective, that's fulfilled by the Business Efficiency Board, the details of which are outlined at section 4 of the report. Also just wanted to point out in section 4.6 to 4.8 that the CIPFA's position statement on audit committee states that audit committees should do a self-assessment of their own effectiveness. That was undertaken by the Audit and Governance Subcommittee in the year, and an annual report was produced, and that annual report is also attached at Appendix D of the report. Finally, in terms of risk management, myself as head of internal audit at Merseytravel, I'm a member of the Primary Assurance and Risk Group. That's attended by relevant managers and it's chaired by Merseytravel's Director of Resources, Tom Fogarty, also the Treasurer of the Constituting Combined Authority. The key roles and responsibilities of PARC, as it's known, are detailed in paragraph 5.3. A risk register for the combined authority has not yet been produced. However, that is because the combined authority's risks are so intrinsically linked at present with Merseytravel's core functions and risks, and consequently are reflected in the existing corporate risk register for Merseytravel. Those key strategic risks are listed at 5.5. The corporate risk register is currently under review by PAR at present, so the revised risk register will be going to the audit in the first instance to the Audit and Governance Subcommittee prior to being presented to the combined authority. In terms of Halton, the Business Efficiency Board fulfills the role of the audit committee defined as through the standards and also in respect of monitoring risk management arrangements. Finally, section 6 is a section on general corporate governance and governance arrangements, which obviously refers to the Code of Corporate Governance, which has been considered by this committee today, so I'm not going to go into any detail on that section. But lastly, at paragraph 6.11 and 6.12, there's just some key points to consider really in terms of things how things may develop and key points for future consideration. That being, there may be a need to, at some point during the future, consider the development of a Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Audit Charter, an audit plan, and a specific audit strategy, and also that the authority itself could and should consider a self-assessment in accordance with the public sector internal audit standards as things develop and mature. And finally, that there will be a need in the future for the development of a specific Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Risk Register. These points will be particularly relevant as it becomes more mature and more responsible for the commission of non-transport activities, including those that are already aware of from the North Deal. I'm quite happy, and Andrew and all as well, and to answer any questions or John, and so I'll get back to you, Chair. Thank you.
Has anyone got any questions, please? I've got a few. It's just a query really to do with the board, and I don't even know if it's the relevant bit. You've got the PTE, haven't you, and then you've got the Merseytravel's committee. and PTE is a body in its own right, and I don't see it in here, I don't see it mentioned in here at all, because in some ways, to be transparent, we need to understand what the PTE does, what the committee, Merseytravel's committee does, and how that impacts on the Liverpool City region. So in some ways, I was just, as it's not mentioned, I just thought I'd ask the question.
Thanks, Chair. Currently, Merseytravel as an entity, Merseytravel's internal audit arrangements, myself as the head of internal audit, our board, in terms of compliance with the standards, is the audit and governance subcommittee. For the combined authorities' internal audit arrangements, at the moment it's placing reliance on the internal audit arrangements that Merseytravel provides and that Halton provides. Looking forward, it may be necessary for it to have its own internal audit arrangements, and as such then those would be subject to assessment against the public sector internal audit standards, and the board, looking ahead in that circumstance, one would expect from this audit committee. That's not the current arrangement, because currently the lines have been placed on the internal audit arrangements at Merseytravel, and the committee that fulfills the board's role for us.
Yeah.
In terms of the interrelationship with Merseytravel as a board of directors, if you like, as well, clearly the internal audit providing a service across Merseytravel but reports to the audit governance subcommittee of the combined authority. So it through the internal audit service, the audit and governance committee is holding the Merseytravel board, if you like, to account in terms of not just its decisions, but the application of those decisions and the general standards of corporate governance throughout Merseytravel. And whereas there is quite a complex interrelationship now because of the changes in governance, in terms of practicalities, the Council of Cows audit and governance committee receive reports of the internal audit service based on, you know, levels of risk and where there are high risk areas and high risk recommendations made, and also can hold to account officers, including directors, who are not complying with internal audit recommendations.
Thank you. I've read through the governance arrangements, and I think it's interesting. We've got them, and it's just a question really. 6.2, foundations of the Code of Corporate Governance. We say what we're going to do, but nowhere do we ever say how we're going to do it. And I was just interested, this may not be your remit, if you know what I mean, it might be a wider business planning thing, I don't know. But we say what we're going to do, we've got a long list of wonderful statements where we're all against everything, or for everything, but how will we actually demonstrate that?
Thanks, Chair. These six principles that are listed at 6.2 are the six principles of that are outlined in the Delivering Good Governance in Local Government, the Sit for Solace guidance that we are bound by. The details of how we will address these, or how the Liverpool City Region can address these, is contained within the Code of Corporate Governance itself, which is the next agenda item. So, apologies there, I didn't go into a great amount of detail because I felt that we would be addressing that in the next agenda item.
Thank you. Have
you
got any more questions? Recommendations. Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Audit Committee is recommended to note and provide comments in respect of the 2014-15 Combined Authority Internal Audit Arrangements and agree to the continuation of these arrangements in 2015-2016. Are we all all right with that? Agreed. Right, thank you.
Building on that, it's important that the CA demonstrates appropriate standards of governance clearly. It is responsible for collecting and distributing around £300 million a year in toll Audit oversees that. It's not directly providing that function. Clearly, that's been delegated to Holton and to Merseytravel, and for other funding streams in the future, it'll be delegated throughout the six constituent districts. However, as the overseeing body, it is important that the governance framework, if you like, is in place. So, without going through this in particular detail, the Code of Corporate Governance is being presented here in draft, and subject to comments, recommendations that this can be passed up to the combined authority for approval and for adoption by the city region. It's based around best practice in local government. It should be entirely familiar to you from that which has been adopted in your own constituents, your own constituent districts. In terms of how we do it, it does put a little bit more meat on the bones in terms of accountability, transparency, integrity, inclusivity, effectiveness, and making sure that the decisions are focused on community outcomes. The code will be reviewed every year, and this committee will be instrumental in that process. The review of governance will feed then into the audit of the annual governance statement, which you've already heard will be form part of the statutory accounts. Will be auditors will have an opinion on, and that opinion will be within the public domain. One thing in particular you may wish to refer to is page 45, which contains the role and functions of this audit committee, which is lifted directly from the CA's constitution. And if we go down that, it should be quite familiar. It should be easy to slot in some of the issues that have already been raised this morning by both the external auditors and our internal auditors, including the review of internal audit, which Stephanie's just mentioned. You need to be assured of the effectiveness of those internal audit arrangements. One area that I would like to pick out, because it does sit slightly out on its own, is treasury management, which is within the remit of this audit committee. You need to have assurance of the effectiveness of the CA's treasury management strategies. The function will be undertaken by Merseytravel as the accountable body and effectively as the banker for the combined authority. But you do need to be aware that the sums of money that we're talking about are incredibly significant, and with growth fund money, they just become of an extremely large scale. So as the committee that's charged with overseeing treasury management, I think it's important that you receive assurance from us of the effectiveness and appropriateness of our treasury management strategies and policies. So what I'm intending to do is to report on those at a subsequent meeting, quite soon, possibly the next meeting, so you're aware of those arrangements. Effectively, they are the same arrangement, they mirror Merseytravel's arrangements, but the scale of money that will be passing through the combined authority means that that's quite an important task for this committee. Other than that, I think there's nothing I would wish to directly pick out further from this code of corporate governance. But obviously, I'm happy to answer any questions that you have on it, Chair.
Got any questions? Anybody? So far?
Would it be possible to the statements, whatever possible, to support the democratic principles? It's all democratic principles because it's across the whole city.
So that not reflect, right, so feel that's not reflected in the current one? Right, okay. Well, yes, probably, yeah, we can try to reflect that when it goes up to the combined authority.
Any more questions? I've got one.
Page 41,
and it's just a technical question, really. We know at the moment that there's an issue over the accountable body status. There's actually been issues raised about whether the European Union recognised them and all the rest of it to do with that sort of thing. So I was just wondering if you had any information in relation to that, because as a background, the overview and scrutiny committee for the Liverpool City Region are about to start a piece of work looking at European funding and how it's been used, not used, or whatever else. So I just wondering whether you have any information on that.
Acutely aware of the issue, and probably provide an update subsequently. I think we're probably at the same stage of understanding as you are in terms of the EU's view of the left, and it's trying to tease out those funding streams and the accountable body issues with the new governance structure. But we're working very, very closely with the left to try and make sure that whatever the determination is doesn't have any impact on the delivery. Because of the importance of all that funding stream, the most important thing is that it forms out, it turns into outcomes. And I think that's all I can probably say on that.
Thank you. Right, can we move to the recommendations? Right, Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Audit Committee is recommended to consider and provide comments in respect to the draft Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Code of Corporate Governance 2014 and 15, and recommend to the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority and the Code of Corporate Governance be approved, subject to any comments and amendments suggested by members, as with Councillor Carr. Are we agreed? Agreed. Thank you. Right, now we move to the final item, which is any other urgent business approved by the Chair. We have one item, which is about substitution. And this may reflect within the constitution, but we are concerned that as a small committee, we only have a few people. You know what I mean? We only have a few people who sit on this committee, and we're interested in actually looking at developing a substitution system. So I would request that the officers actually look at that and bring it back to the next meeting.
Yes.
That's it. Fine. And with that, thank you very much.